31 well-lived years. That boy lived it to the max. Always had a smile on his face. He never met a stranger, and everybody loved him. And that was just Mark. Had that altruistic spirit. He was always helping somebody else, despite what it cost him. And that's the way we're all supposed to be. He was a great son. He was a great brother. He was a great husband. He was a great daddy. He was a great friend. And I know we'll see him soon, because I also know he was a great Christian. And I know he's in heaven. And I know I'm headed there too.
Once the getting was good, and now the getting has got gone. I'm going downtown just to tie one on. I'm okay, aged and sour. I'm going down by the hour, and I'm as blue as the night is long. So won't someone dance with me to a waltz about whiskey and turn my sad song to lullaby? Well, I don't need much of nothing except for all your loving and a waltz about whiskey all night. One quarter will do. Number 832. Little truth from the jukebox will make it all right. As the blues sets in, I'm getting high again to a waltz about a whiskey on ice. So won't someone dance with me to a waltz about a whiskey and turn my sad song to a lullaby? Well, I don't need much of nothing except for all your loving and a waltz about a whiskey all night. I remember the night she sat down beside me, cried, love is a ring that won't end. I was handed a lie, and now the only thing that I know about a ring is the circle that my glass leaves behind. So won't someone dance with me to a waltz about a whiskey and turn my sad song to lullaby? I don't need much of nothing except for all your loving. Waltz about whiskey, oh, night.
When Stephen Cox were here, we were using his air compressor. It's the VMAC, and that thing is insanely awesome. Puts out 30 CFM at 150 PSI, 100% duty cycle, which means all the time. This guy has a 5-horsepower motor. Supposedly, it puts out 11 CFM at 90 PSI, and I got to tell you, I don't believe that. It just doesn't have the power, man. So I'm going to connect this tank to my other air compressor, and we'll run them both simultaneously until I can get another air solution for the shop that actually works. Okay, so here's what I've done. We're all plumbed up. We're all screwed into the wall. I got 1, 2, 3 outlets now. And then we're going to plumb this directly to this tank. And then I've got to wire this one in. Okay, the clouds rolled in, ladies and gentlemen. So once again, rainy East Texas. So let's see if we can at least get this hood done.
lover come over and look what I've done. I've been alone so long, it feels like I'm on the run. Lover, come over and kick up the dust. I've got a secret, I'm starting to rush. She said I'm looking like a bad man, a smooth criminal. She said my spirit doesn't move like it did before. She said I don't look like me no more, no more. I said I'm just tired. She said you're just high. I said I saw you in the water.
In case you're wondering what sandblasting is like,
I said I saw you in the bar.
It sucks. I don't know if I can open my eyes. Oh.
Well, lover, come hold me. My head's on the fritz. Gaudy, intoxicated feelings, comfortably mixed. Well, lover, come hold me. Could you forget? I've got a secret. Digging a ditch, she said I'm looking like a bad man, smooth criminal. She said my spirit doesn't move like it did before. She said I don't look like me no more, no more. She said I'm just tired. She said I'm just high. Said I saw you in the water. Letting all your sins out, putting all your thoughts back together. Oh, we just don't blend now. All of my attempts seem to weather. Oh, I make you cringe now. Don't I make you cringe? Oh, I make you cringe now. Oh, I make you cringe. Doesn't move like it did before. She said, I don't look like me no more, no more. I said, I'm just tired. She said, you're just high. Said, I saw you in the water.
Okay, so we're just blasting through this stuff with Roger from Roger's Fix It Born. He's getting this guy all set up, the radiator straightening the fins. I got the hood completed. It's all welded up. All the rust has been taken care of, and now I need to weld it all back together. And I've got the CRC rust converter underneath here. I'll come back and sand that a little bit, just real lightly. And so this was all sanded, but that's like a layer of primer that really protects it. And then here is the other part that gets welded back in. So it'll never have rust problems again. That's fantastic. Right now I'm working on getting all the 70 years worth of grime and paint off the bottom of these two pieces. Oh my gosh, it's such a pain. And then as we complete the pieces, I just bring them outside and I paint them. And this is a tractor, you know, it's a very simple paint process. You clean everything up and you slap some paint on there. Okay, we got her back up on the bench. Okay, let me show you this. I've got the side, this side in, that is the side without the arms on it, right? And I got it back in here, and you can see that's where my spot welds are. Now the spot welds, see that little ring right there? It'll tell you exactly where it wants to be. So I get to put this back right where it was, and then we're gonna come in and I'll tighten it down, weld this one, move a clamp over here, tighten it all the way down until those are in. Then what we'll do is we're gonna come back to this side, do the exact thing, same thing, get it all lined up with the holes. I've even got it bolted in wherever I have a bolt hole. So there's one there and there's one over here, and then we'll take this one and bolt it in. But first we're gonna weld this piece right here in. All right, you hear all that clacking and popping? I've got a good bead there, but she needs more power. Too much crackling. We're gonna go a little hotter. So this side's all welded in, and now we'll get this support pushed up into place. But we're gonna weld this part right here last. We're gonna come over, put our bolts in here, and then line up all these spot welds, And then we're going to make sure that everything is kind of square. We'll measure from side to side before we tack this side in. It's fine to tack this side in. And usually when all of your holes match up, it's fine. You don't have to worry about it. But go ahead and throw a square on there just in case, you know. Okay, they're all welded back together. We'll just clean up these spot welds, and that's fantastic. You'll never know that it was taken off. And now the frame is back on. Everything is straight. And what we did there was we solved that problem with the rust in the back, and it won't happen again for a very, very long time because we have a very, very good product on here that's keeping that from happening. Of course, we're going to go under here and shoot paint, but you can imagine paint doesn't get back here in these corners. It's not going to get up underneath there. So that extra layer of protection we added, as well as, you know, just around the spot weld, about where you see that burn, there's no rust proofing. But everything around there from here over is rust proofing. So now this hood is ready for probably, I don't know, after you restore a tractor, usually you get maybe 100 years out of them. I'm not really showing a lot of the bodywork, but I do want to give you guys a couple little pointers. So I'm using an Evercoat product called Easy Sand, and it is a flowable polyester filler. Now, this stuff flows out really easy. It's really nice to wipe, but it's not really made for filling big dents. And if you have big dents, remove your big dents. So for this entire project, I have not used any Bondo on it whatsoever because we have light waves in here. So I'm not filling this. This isn't thick at all. Listen. It's very, very thin, right? And probably, you know, it's thicker than primer, but it's pretty thin. I'm using 80 grit. Now, 80 grit is actually too much for this. You don't really want to use it, but the way that I do this will help you guys out so much. The reason you don't is because you put sand scratches in there, and this is so thin, you have to know your stopping point, right? But the reason I prefer to use 80 first is you always want to cut, right? We are literally in the process of removing material. I know that that sounds weird, but you have to think about how that happens, okay? So when you're coming across it, if I put a lot of pressure on this, it's going to unevenly wave and move that material because the block will be flexing on it. And I like a foamy block. I made this one. And I got a little V-groove there and a V-groove on that side. And it really fits my fingers well. But I come in like this. And guys, the key to this, right? Number one is pressure. Do not put a lot of pressure on it. You don't require a lot of pressure when you're using a good quality filler material. So evenly sand your entire area, right? All the way around. You don't want any, you want to feather everything out. So always have a good feather on all your edges. Don't go too deep before you switch grits. What we're going to be finishing this off with is 180 grit, right? And so nice, easy, and then switch directions. Nice and easy. Nice and easy. I swear it's probably the block plus a roll of quarters. That's the weight that's being put on here. And look, it's sanding just fine. Right? I'm barely touching it. When you go into your other stuff like this, you're not wearing yourself out. You're just cutting it. Just cutting the filler. So don't use a lot of pressure. Sand it easy because it's easy sand, and it'll work out fine for you. Now, as far as body fillers work, use only high-end body fillers, guys. Do not waste your time on Bondo brand or anything like that, and you'll end up with really good results because you're not fighting the sand, material, right? If I get some Bondo on there and it's Bondo brand or it's some hard Bondo or like a $30 a gallon can of Bondo, and I'm in here trying to cut it, it's not my high spots. I'm going to be pushing down on it. It's going to be rolling over the block, and it's going to start sanding the edges before it sands the high spots. It doesn't cut it. You're literally like, think of it almost like a wood plane where you're shaving the top off to get down to a flat surface over an even plane. Don't think of it as removing material with sandpaper. It's a little different. That maybe visually that'll help you out. So look at all of our edges. You'll end up with this, right? And we're a little high low right in here. There's some waves in there. The primer will take care of most of that, but right here we definitely got to feather this out, right? You can see all of our edges need to be feathered, so you got to leave it higher than it needs to be with this guy before you switch over. Okay, let's talk about pinholes real quick, because a lot of times you get pinhole primer pinholes, and people don't know how to deal with that and where it comes from. So a lot of body guys will come in and they'll beat their dent out the best they can. They'll pull it out and then it's called cave and pave. They'll come back in and they'll put a bunch of Bondo on there and they'll sand it with some 36 grit paper. This is just 80 grit and you can see the sanding scratches are pretty big in there, right? So you can imagine if you came back with some of this over some 36 grit scratches and you wiped it over it, it would trap air inside there. Then when you sanded this down, you would end up in all these little lines, you'd end up with little air pockets, little bubbles, and you would cut half that bubble off and that gives you a little dip inside there, a little hole kind of like that, you know, like half a sphere where the air was trapped. And those are pinholes, and you're not going to get those out with primer. Primer cannot, the surface tension on the primer, so like let's say this is the hole, the surface tension on the primer will hold the primer from going all the way down in there, and you'll never get that pinhole out. Huge problem, right? So what you do is you need to finish your Bondo with like at least 80 grit before you go to put easy sand on. Now my suggestion is 180, but I eliminate all of that by doing the body work really well with a hammer first, right? All this was done with a hammer. This is not thick at all. You can see metal coming through here. And it's just, you know, the nature of it. You want to see that metal. You want to see it thin. Keep your body work light. And those are key things to remember. And you'll end up with a good quality job. Of course, after this, we'll hit it with primer. We'll go back and sand that primer too. Primer's really good about showing us any imperfections or anything we may have missed. Now, you can see I've got my hand on this. We're going to have to come back in here and DA this entire thing because, let's see, yeah, there's some fingerprints right here. Right there, you can see them. Every single place where my fingers had touched this, and you can just see that. Look, it'll leave a mark. Every place where my fingers touch this, it's going to rust, and that paint's going to come off. So I'm going to DA this entire thing. I finally found some gloves. This is all I could find. But I'll DA this entire thing, and I'll use some wax and grease remover on it before we get the primer on there, and it'll remove all of that rust, and we won't have any issues. Now, what that looks like is if you get a fresh paint job and you see a bubble underneath the paint, that's where it comes from. It's not necessarily the bodywork. It's because someone, when it was out in metal, they touched it with their hands, their bare hands.
I want to thank everybody watching this for being here for his journey. You know, making videos for y'all was really a joy to him, something that was a source of joy in his life. Just so much positivity and so much love from so many people that you guys provided him a level of support that I could have never done by myself. So I want to thank every single one of you.
You remind me of a Sunday back home in old Kentucky, where the church choirs just belted to the pines.
Cancer is not a game of winners and losers.
And I love you like the mountains, love the way the morning opens to a soft and bright greeting from the sun.
It's not the battle part that bothers me.
So if it make you stay,
it's the losing part.
I wouldn't act so angry all the time. I wouldn't keep it all inside, and I'd let you know how much I loved you every
For those who ultimately die from a cancer, the idea that they have lost a battle implies to me,
so darling, if you stay right here and shake this frost off of my bones,
that if they had done something else differently, then maybe they might have won. If they do not survive, then please let us not blame them inadvertently for losing the battle against cancer. He did not lose his battle with cancer.
Well, I used to ride a Mustang. I'd run that thing on high hopes till they raised the price of dreams so high.
He lived graciously and courageously with it until the very end.
So I let that car just sit there when I should have took you driving with the windows down.
In many, many ways, by inspiring and teaching us, he won.
If it make you stay, act so angry all the time. Wouldn't keep it all inside, and I'd let you know how much I love you every day. So darling, if you stay right here, shake this frost off of my bone.
He was a wonderful role model right to the end. He did not lose his battle with cancer. He won his battle. He loved you all. Thank you for being
darling,
here.
Darling, if you stay right here, shake this frost off of my bone.